Soy loco por ti, América. Soy loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Soy loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Loco por ti de amores.
Good morning. My name is Lloyd Day. I'm the Deputy Director General of the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation on Agriculture, ICA. Welcome to the continuation of ICA seminars with high-level policymakers across the Americas and the Caribbean. During these days of virtual work, ICA has been actively engaged in a series of dialogues with agricultural leaders from across the Western Hemisphere, such as Rebecca Greenspan, the Ibero-American Secretary General, Enrique Iglesias, the former president of the IDB, Juan Lucas Restrepo, Director General of Biodiversity in CIAT, Elsa Morano, the Director of the Borlaug Center of Texas A&M, among others. Today, our focus is the dynamic and vibrant agricultural sector of North America that serves as a model for the whole world on how to integrate a regional economy. This regional integration began with the North American Free Trade Agreement in 1994 that was superseded by the United States, Mexico, Canada, the USMCA agreement in July 2020, just a few weeks ago. In terms of trade, the size of the agricultural economies of North America represents one of the largest global agricultural economies in the world. And the regional agricultural trade among the three countries is nearly $100 billion business annually. Today, we are joined by Manuel Otero, Director General of ICA, a veterinarian from Argentina with decades of experience with the ICA and serving as a senior staff and representative in multiple countries, including Brazil, Costa Rica, Uruguay, and Peru. Prior to ICA, Manuel served as the vice president of Argentina's National Institute of Agricultural Technology and also as Argentina's attaché, agricultural attaché to the United States. Frederic Seppi, assistant deputy minister of the Market and Industry Services Branch of the Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada, AAFC. Frederic is Canada's chief agricultural negotiator with AAFC and the Canada-US Regulatory Cooperation Council. Prior to his career with Agriculture Canada, Frederic served with Canada's Privy Council, the Department of Foreign Affairs, the Department of Finance, and the Treasury Board Secretariat. Ken Isley, USDA's Foreign Agricultural Service. Ken leads the USDA's 93 offices around the world in expanding trade opportunities for U.S. agriculture. Ken also chairs the USDA's Interdepartmental Coordination Committee on International Affairs. Prior to USDA, Ken served in senior positions with Corteva Agrisciences Agricultural Division of Dow DuPont, including vice president, general counsel, and head of the company's global legal department. Miguel Garcia Winder, Mexico's Undersecretary of Agriculture. Miguel is an agronomist and animal sciences specialist by training, who has worked in management positions in academia, industry, and international organizations. Most recently, before joining the Mexican Secretary of Agriculture and Rural Development, Miguel served as ICA's representative to the United States and Director of Agribusiness and Competitiveness. As you can see, we have a powerhouse lineup for today's seminar. More importantly, they are all good friends of ICA. As a former USDA official who worked on the trade relationship with our partners in Mexico and Canada, I am very pleased to serve as moderator of this event. To begin, I'd like to turn it over to the Director General of ICA to start things off and to give his perspective on these seminars and the role of ICA. Dr. Otero.
Well, thank you, Lloyd, for this comprehensive introduction. And let me join you in giving a warm welcome to Frederic, Ken, and Miguel. The main idea of this dialogue is to talk about the situation and perspectives of the agriculture sector in the northern region of the Americas. We work in ICA, spend most of the time talking about agriculture in Latin America and the Caribbean region, but quite often we forget that the northern region is crucial a part of this continent with a great deal of influence worldwide. Something very important happened early this year related with the beginning of a new trade agreement, better known as USMCA, that in fact is a continuation and hopefully an improvement of the NAFTA signed in 1994. Taking into account that agriculture is one of the major sectors that will be affected by this new trade agreement, the first question is related, in order to hear your opinions regarding which are your expectations in terms of benefits, concerns that this new trade agreement will bring about. So for opening the fire, this dialogue, I would like to offer the mic to Frederick. Frederick, please, your comments.
Thank you very much, Director General, and thank you for this kind invitation to participate on this panel. I'm very pleased that to see again, although it's virtually, to see again good friends and colleagues, and to be on this panel with Miguel and Ken. And I think that it's by having activities of this kind that we can show how the agriculture sector can be resilient. Life goes on, and we need to maintain our engagement. As you can see, I'm working, like many others, I'm working from home. And where I live in Quebec, there's many people put in their window signs with a rainbow and saying, it will be okay. And I find that this is the situation in which we are. We need to, life goes on, and we need to be focused on the needs of the agricultural sector right now. So I think that the experience that we had in Canada is that the action of each and every one of us can make a huge difference. So, and I think it's especially true for our farmers, our ranchers, our food workers, which are truly every day, they are heroes. Now, to your question about the impact that USMCA or CUSMA, as we call it in Canada, I think that with its entry into force on July 1st, the first comment I would make is that it was a seamless transition so far. And you will note that I believe that it almost coincided, the entry into force coincided with the last AICA ministerial meeting that we held. And I noted that the Secretary Villalobos, Secretary Perdue, and Minister Bibeau each took the time in their speech to highlight that the coming into force of USMCA was an historical moment and milestone. We think it's a great milestone for our trilateral relationship in North America. And we believe that more than ever, stability, predictability of trade are more important than ever in these uncertain times. Of course, as you pointed out, Director General, the USMCA was preceded by almost 30 years of operating under NAFTA. So it starts with a very solid, strong foundation. But I think that as any agreements, from time to time, you need to update it. And in USMCA, we have, I think, been quite successful in terms of making that adjustment. Not only it continues to provide the environment of that helps our agricultural and agri-food sectors in the three countries to operate in an integrated way in North America, but I think that it also strengthens our competitiveness of our common operators on the world stage, because it is a powerful trade entities. It maintains, of course, all the advantages that we had under the NAFTA, the duty-free trade, and the agricultural commitments that we exchanged more than almost 30 years ago. But it also reinforced our economic relationship. And we know that how important that could be. I'll give you just an illustration, is that despite the fact that for public health reason, the United States and Canada have agreed to close our border. You can imagine how tough it is, because especially in Canada, where 90% of the population lives within 100 kilometers of the Canada-US border, and we are used to cross all the time both ways. Wow. Well, what is interesting is that when you look at the trucking, the crossing of the border by trucks, last week, we were almost at the same level as the same week a year ago. Yes, cumulatively, we're still 30% less trucking traffic, border crossings. But you can see that because of the essential nature of the trade, we are mutually dependent on each other for our supply. Our meat market are fully integrated. We have hogs that are going every day to the U.S. to be slaughtered. We care about the situation of slaughterhouses in the U.S., and we know the U.S. care about the situation north of the border. So that's an illustration that even at times of challenges as we face right now, it makes a big difference. And I'll just flag that in a number of areas, there's really significant improvement in terms of modernization. Innovative provisions on biotechnologies that we hope really help to stimulate innovation. And I'm sure Ken can talk from his current and previous experience, can talk with a lot of credibility about the importance of these elements. We have also improved on the sanitary and phytosanitary disciplines. And we know that if in North America, and it's true in the Americas, because many of the free trade agreements across the hemisphere have the same feature, if we have the right disciplines and state-of-the-art disciplines, we can inspire the rest of the world to obey to these provisions. So these are just a few examples how USMCA is building and strengthening what was already in the NAFTA. The last point I would make at this point is that one element is, it's not only the commitments that matter in a trade agreement. It is also the way it empowers the collaboration and the cooperation, not only among governments, but business to business. And there's a threat that exists out there that we all care. And in North America, we are really working together on, and it's the threat of the African swine fever. And I think that it shows, and we discussed that at AICA from time to time, this is by having these arrangements like USMCA, like AICA, we can really work together to make sure that we find global solution and regional solutions to address global challenges. So I'll just leave it at that.
Thank you, Frederick. I will pass the mic to Ken. I am very much interested in also in your comments about innovation, Ken.
Thank you very much, Director General. And first, I want to thank you for successfully hosting the 40th Executive Committee. And thank you for inviting me to participate on this panel concerning the Northern Region. More importantly, I want to convey the appreciation on behalf of Ag Secretary Perdue, Undersecretary McKinney, and all of us at USDA for the work of yourself and your colleagues at AICA to promote agricultural production, trade, and the use of innovation in the Western Hemisphere. That's particularly true during the challenges we're currently faced with COVID-19. Next, I want to convey my greetings to my colleagues on the panel, to Frederick and to Miguel, and look forward to participating with them. Now, I got to say, I pity Miguel for going third on this issue, because what I'm going to say is going to be very common to some of the issues that Frederick brought up earlier in his remarks. You know, while we do have issues that we continue to work through between the three countries, those issues are really at the margins of our relationship. And make no mistake that the strength of the bonds between our three great countries are very great. And that's demonstrated again and again, but more recently by the enactment of USMCA, which went into effect on July 1st, 2020. First and foremost, on behalf of U.S. agriculture, on behalf of our farmers and ranchers, the number one benefit of USMCA, it preserves the stability of NAFTA, that agreement that had endured for 25 to 30 years between our great countries and underpinned so much trade between us. The U.S. enjoys both in exports and imports greater than $90 billion of movement between our border to Canada and our border to Mexico. We have $48 billion of agricultural and food trade with Mexico and $45 billion in ag and food trade with Canada back in 2019. This represented our first and second largest markets for export of U.S. food and agricultural products in 2019, particularly as we were dealing with the trade disruption with China during that time period. We value very, very much that relationship. And it's not just one, two, or three products. It actually cuts across the full diversity of agricultural products coming from the U.S., corn at greater than $3 billion, prepared foods right at $3 billion, dairy, fresh vegetables, fresh fruit, pork, soybeans, beef, poultry, all the way across our industry. So it's an incredibly important agreement and incredibly important trade relationships between the U.S., Canada, and Mexico. Second, let me turn my attention to the other great benefit of USMCA, and that's the modernization of NAFTA. It's the first trade agreement to address agricultural biotechnology. It also includes updated sanitary and phytosanitary measures, which promote transparency and the use of modern science and data in regulating the importation of food. It encourages agricultural innovation, which is needed to feed the growing population, not just with the quantity of production required, but also with the quality of products that are produced with that new technology. It promotes trade throughout the Western Hemisphere. The agreement also addresses the use of geographic indicators to distinguish common names in a more appropriate way. So we applaud the efforts of our colleagues from Canada and Mexico in completing the agreement, and as my colleague from Canada has already said, to seamlessly implement that agreement, which we have been doing for so long, and to ensure the flow both to and from our countries during this difficult period we're going through, and to show the resilience and sustainability of our supply chains across the northern region in the Western Hemisphere. And I will stop there, but believe me, I'll circle back on ag innovation very shortly with the next couple questions. Thank you very much, Director General.
Hello, Miguel?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. I couldn't hear the introduction, Director General. Thank you very much. Hopefully my English won't be that bad for the rest of the audience, and I'll try to go slow, but Allow me to start by conveying our condolences to everyone who has been affected by this disease. I know Costa Rica has been somehow isolated, but the rest of the world is facing a tremendous challenge on health issues. So our condolences, especially to our producers, the agro-food industry that is being affected. Secondly, I want to convey the regards from Secretary Villalobos. He is aware of this conversation. And I guess there is no need to emphasize his commitment to continue to support ICA's work throughout the hemisphere and beyond if possible. So let me, it's kind of hard to add something new, but I will try to add something new to the conversation on the potential benefits that this TEMEC, as we call them in our side, and you can see that's one of the big differences. We call it difference in French, in English, and Spanish, so hopefully we'll have one single denomination by the end of the administration. But let me try to put this in perspective. I think we are facing a very particular situation with the disease that will affect many of the things we do. But in terms of the TEMEC, I think we have an opportunity to look in the long view, even for the recovery of the economic activity after the pandemic, but that should not be the center. I think TEMEC, and in 2017, while we were still at ICA, we organized a seminar, which brought together private sector producers and government organizations to discuss the future of NAFTA. At that time we called it NAFTA, in the area of agriculture. And everybody agreed that agriculture was one of the sectors that benefited the greatest with NAFTA. And whatever, at that time, the negotiations, what it was proposed is that we should prevent any harm to what was already gained. And I think that was achieved on the new term. So we prevented any harm to the previous gains that we had in NAFTA. Therefore, I see the TEMEC with very high optimism for the future and the integration of agriculture. Hopefully in the second round, I would like to put what I consider to be the major challenge for the three countries. In preventing doing harm, I think the new TEMEC offers some good possibilities to make progress. First of all, it intends to reduce red tape at the border, and that's quite important. I think reducing the process of the flow of merchandise, it becomes one of the major keys in the trade. It's not without challenges, because together with illicit activities, we have an increase in illicit activities and reducing red border, reducing red tape at the border could increase the potential movement of illegal goods. But that's one of the big challenges and the big benefits of this new TEMEC, is reduce the red tape. The other, as a consequence of this, I think the new TEMEC bring a reduction in cost, the cost of products and the cost of food, that will at the end benefit the society. Just by reducing the red tape and allowing the better integration of food chains, because in reality today we are talking about an integrated food sector. Companies from Canada have subsidiaries in the United States and Mexico. Companies in the United States have subsidiaries in Canada and Mexico. And at the end, we are having a better integration of agri-food chains. And just to give you an example, you can look at berries today. And berries basically an integrated international North American value chain. So the other area that I see a benefit on this new TEMEC is an increase in transparency. I think with the advent of new rules and needs, particularly on the intellectual property rights, which has all the issues with innovation, with the issue of labor, with the issue of traceability, increased transparency becomes an important. And that will allow to governments to have a more precise, and consumers particularly, more precise knowledge of where the products is coming from, how it was produced. And it will also force the manufacturers, including the producers, to comply to new sets of social regulations, like better environmental rules. One of the important issues is that it's the first time that it somehow provides for some elements for labor issues, which are very important for agriculture, particularly child labor and forced labor. I think the TEMEC has a very important role in reducing forced labor and child labor in agriculture, which is one of our major challenges. I would say not only in Mexico, but across the continent. You just look at what happened with crops like coffee, when a lot of child unpaid labor is working in these fields. And so TEMEC will help us to clarify this and make it more equal among the three countries. The other big benefit that I think was not highlighted, but needs to be highlighted, are environmental benefits. We are trying to homologize our environmental concepts and environmental regulations. And, you know, I think this is something very interesting, because on one side we have new innovations, and on the other hand we have environmental issues, and sometimes they do not see eye to eye and they don't match to each other. And I think that's one of the major challenges, is how do we allow for the new technologies to progress and at the same time comply with new environmental regulations, regulations that are impacting water use and energy use and so on. But I think that's a very important issue on TEMEC. And then the other aspect, just to finalize today, has to do with investment. I think it provides new rules for investments. And I think we need to take advantage of that to promote investment in agriculture and investment for agriculture. Because I think that's one of the major challenges that we have across the continent, is how do we increase investment in agriculture, investment in public goods, roads, warehouses, whole change, irrigation system, soil management, that type of things. Hopefully with TEMEC, we are going to be able to have a better transparency on investments to favor the investments. We are at the initial stages of TEMEC, but again, I think agriculture is one of the sectors that was less affected. The new provisions in place will increase the integration of the three countries and will prevent that the gains of the last 26 years will be lost. I think we are seeing TEMEC as a tremendous opportunity for continued expanding the competitiveness of the Mexican sector. And I will stop right there, Director General. Thank you so much for this opportunity. But I see these are the benefits of the new TEMEC for agriculture. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Miguel. Let me move on to the second question, related with the fact that Canada, US, and Mexico are within the list of the 10 major agriculture exporting nations, channeling part of their production to the international markets. So I would like to understand, to hear your opinion about the possible scenarios at the global level. Do you foresee any comeback to some protectionist era? I would like to start off in this second question with Miguel. Miguel, the mic is yours.
Hopefully, by now my English is getting better, so you can understand me. Let me, since this is an opportunity to think and to reflect and put conversations on the table, I don't want to put any numbers. I intentionally try to avoid the numbers today because I know ICA has two great groups that provide all the numbers. But let me tell you what I think is the major challenge that we have in AFTA. And I think the major challenge that we have in TEMEC, TEMEC, is that the three countries should sit together and define how we as a region are going to be more competitive at the world stage. I think it's time for us to stop just looking at the merchandise flow between Mexico, Canada, and the United States, and start looking how do we put together our competitive forces, our advantages, to tackle the global arena. I believe that that's the major challenge for this type of NAFTA. I think it will require a different way of thinking. It will require a way of thinking that make Canada, United States, and Mexico as a single group, as a single country, rather than to compete and gain market share among the three countries. I think the market share that we have with United States and with Canada has a little margin to increase. We provide already a big amount of food to United States. United States provide a big amount of food to Mexico. But the challenge is how do we compete with other parts of the world? How do we compete with South America? Or how do we bring South America into this NAFTA, so we can compete against the big powers of the European Union or the Asian countries? And I think that's the major challenge. I, however, see some three issues that can derail TEMEC, or at least, if not derail TEMEC, at least will present some obstacles. The first issue that I see is the potential of protectionism and nationalism. And I be responsible if I don't bring some of these subjects into the conversation. Right now, we are facing, in Mexico, we are facing the threat of imposing seasonality tariffs to some of our products. And that is going against the central spirit of the new agreement. If that comes into place, then it will prompt a response from Mexico to this seasonality that will affect TEMEC. So we should work as a government officials to prevent all these unnecessary and irrational measurements to prevent trade. And I would say there is some issues from the Mexican side also, because and that has to do with changes in environmental regulation and changes in social perception. Social perception, for example, in Mexico, is having a big impact on the use of the transgenic crops and some new technology and some new products for pesticides use. If we don't work to prevent that as much as we can, then this can put a block for the progress of them. And I think that's probably some of the major challenges. And I'm saying it's only part of one country or other country. I think we, the three countries, have to continue to work to prevent this. And that's why having this type of conversation, having an open dialogue, and I had to recognize Secretary Villalobos and the Minister of Canada and the Secretary of the United States on their openness and willingness to maintain an open conversation on these issues. I had the privilege to be in these meetings, and I had to recognize the desire of the three ministers to have a smooth integration of agriculture in the two countries. And I think that's probably the major challenge that we are facing. I believe these are transitory. I believe these are short in time. At the long term, I think the three countries are going to survive. But again, I want to summarize my intervention saying our major challenge is how do we transform our trilateral flow of merchandise to conform a big block to compete into the international arena, because North America, as you said, we are among the 10 top exporting countries of food in the world. So I think it's time to go to it. The second is how do we prevent this unexpected, I don't want to say protectionism, but unexpected burst of particular interest that could prevent the full integration. And in the case of Mexico, I see one of the major challenges that we have is how do we add value to our products? And I think that's one of the major challenges, is how do we move from a commodity exporter to a value-added exporter? And that's why I think that integrating the three countries will give us the tremendous opportunity to compete at the worldwide stage. And I think that's the major challenge. I put that on the table for conversation. I know some of these topics are uncomfortable, but they are the reality. And we are working, I have to say, we are working very closely among the three countries to prevent any disruption in trade. And one important thing that we agree is we want to have science-based decisions to guide whatever we at the policy level do in order to prevent damages to the integration of the agricultural sector. Thank you, Director General.
We'll pass the mic to Frederick, please.
Yeah, thank you very much, Director General. And I think I will just follow on the wave of Miguel. Yeah, when I was considering your question and opportunities, my first reaction to say that, yes, we need to look forward in terms of opportunities. But first, we have to recognize that right now we are facing a number of challenges and threats. And Director General, you raised that in your introduction to the current session. There is definitely, we need to safeguard from a Canadian perspective, and although we are in the a major trading player, we are the fifth largest exporter of agriculture and agri-food products in the world, and we are the fifth largest importer as well. And I always present that some of our stakeholders in Canada would say, oh, well, is it good? Like, exports are good and imports are bad. And I would say, well, definitely for a country like Canada, if I want to enjoy at, well, I think, Miguel, you were describing the blueberry example in your previous intervention, and it's true that if you want, we have more and more in berries or in lettuce. A lot in horticulture, you can see operations that operate in the three countries of the northern regions in a seamless way. And they fully exploit the full potential of the climatic conditions from the southern Ontario all the way down to Mexico. And this is a great reality that, like, trade is important for all of us from a food security perspective. So we need to safeguard the international trading system, as for a medium-sized economy like Canada, this is very important. And we know that there's a temptation at the time of COVID where like there's a lot of uncertainty about the it raised unique situation of food security and self-reliance. We have to be mindful that while it could look at making sense, the trade is so important, so vital to the global food security, the health and the well-being of all citizens in the Americas. Trade allows to have to create jobs, to supply commodities and families with safe, high quality, affordable food. It supports the livelihood of our farmers throughout the regions. And as we emerge from the COVID-19, I think trade will be a key driver for the economic recovery of all our nations. It's definitely true. It's a lot of the focus of discussions in our three countries. I'm sure it is in other countries as well. So what are we doing in Canada? Well, we are actively engaged and we work closely with the United States and Mexico in that regard. We use every opportunity, whether it's AICA, and we salute your leadership, Director General, in organizing, despite the challenges, a number of series of meetings. We're active at the WTO. We chair the Ottawa group that is looking at addressing a number of the questions, the tough but very legitimate questions that a number of members have raised in terms of ensuring that the WTO operates effectively and within the spirit that led to its creation back in 1995. So we're very active there at the G20 and elsewhere. The message is always to make sure that we renew the commitment to international rules, to be transparent about what we're doing to manage COVID-19, and better understand the domestic measures that each of us feel we have to put in place, because it raises concerns sometimes between each others. I think that, Ken, you were saying in the previous panel that while the implementation is smooth, there's issues that are on the, we always have bilateral issues that we can raise among the three of us. But like, we have a system to deal with these and find mutually beneficial solutions. So this is more important than ever to have this kind of discussion. There may be some restrictions that are absolutely necessary to safeguard the food security of domestic countries. But it has to be important that these responses are proportionate to the needs, and that they are consistent with WTO rules. So that's one element where, from a Canadian perspective, we're very attentive to that. And we are ready to sustain the scrutiny of our trading partners and to have a discussion. In terms of opportunities, I like the theme that Miguel mentioned in terms of how can we think more as North America as a kind of a community that can look in the how we can advance collectively our interests in foreign markets. Because yes, we are competitors in certain areas. It's always good to see our pork producers and the meat processors bumping into their American colleagues in various markets in Asia, and it's part of the game. But what the USMCA, preceded by NAFTA, was bringing is that by having the rules of origin that we have, we can really maximize the opportunities through the accumulation. There's investors that bring, foreign investors that bring their money, their capital to North America, because we have an integrated market. So that's where, Miguel, to build on the point you were making, I would see that that's one element of opportunities. I mentioned like that a number of companies are very integrated in the three countries to exploit the differences in climatic condition. That's another example where we can work more together. And I would say regulatory, I will not use the word harmonization, but more better, because we each have our regulatory requirements and legal systems, but regulatory alignment is very important. And when I think, for example, of in biotechnologies, for example, that we are three countries where our regulatory treaties are based their decisions on science and facts. And if there's something that is reviewed or examined or approved in one of our three jurisdictions, in many areas, the level of confidence of our respective regulatory authorities are very high. how can we be more agile, more in terms of regulatory approvals, to approve in a more timely way new innovations, absorb new innovations. That's an area where I think there's a lot of opportunities and where the work of the Northern region can also, sharing our experience, can really help countries in the rest of the hemisphere. So I'll just stop there.
Thank you, Frederick. Ken, your turn, please.
Thank you very much, Director General. And like my two colleagues before me, I'm going to expand the question a little bit to address concerns and potential impediments to trade in the global environment. And often we have to break down those impediments before we can realize the opportunities that exist out there. First and foremost, in agriculture, I think we always need to go back and look at the fundamentals of agricultural supply or production and demand for food, demand to consume what agriculture first and foremost is meant to achieve, and that's feeding the global population. It's a reality that we need to keep in mind in the midst of the COVID pandemic. I'm very proud to lead the Foreign Agricultural Service, who one of our three key strategic pillars is to gather data on agricultural supply and demand all around the world, analyze that data, and make it readily available to everyone in the world to help drive decisions and markets in a very transparent way. As an example, we've published over 430 reports, what we refer to as GAIN reports, on the impact of COVID on agriculture in the various countries around the world. Well, first, let me say production has continued. Agricultural production, and it's not just United States farmers and ranchers, it's those throughout the Western Hemisphere and throughout the world, for that matter, are extraordinarily resilient. I grew up on a farm in the state of Iowa in the United States, and believe me, we were practicing social distancing in the 60s and the 70s and the 80s, even though we didn't refer to it as such. Rural America is rural, and when you drive a tractor all day, you do so in quarantine, in isolation. So let me just say that U.S. ag production and production around the world, for that matter, has continued in the midst of COVID. Now, I do recognize there's some products, horticulture, vegetables, fruits, that require a little more intensive shoulder-to-shoulder labor and work to plant and harvest those crops. But that resilience has shown through in the ability of agriculture to continue production. Now let's talk about consumption. Consumption, people are going to eat. That's the beauty of our industry, is that constant demand of consumption. And as the population increases and as economic prosperity around the world and rising middle classes increases, consumption maintains and increases accordingly, including the types of foods consumed. So in the midst of COVID, there have been changes in consumption patterns. Clearly, restaurants, hotels, things like that have suffered as a result of people not going out as they did before. And food demand has changed to in-home delivery from grocery stores and other things. That's required different packaging. That's required different products being higher in demand than others. But again, the agricultural industry has exemplified its flexibility in reacting to meet those needs. So the second area, once you get beyond supply demand, is supply chain resiliency. Do we have the supply chains in place to connect that supply with the demand on where food is grown? There, we've had some learnings through COVID, frankly. You know, I feel our supply chain has been very resilient, but there's been short-term disruptions, particularly in the processing of agricultural products and food. A lot of that has been highlighted with the meat processing facilities. You could also add fruits, vegetables, processing facilities, have been disrupted because, again, you have close working quarters of personnel. There was a pause there. There was a focus on worker safety and how you could ensure that while also maintaining minimal disruption in the critical food supply chains. I'm happy to report that that was only short term. Our actual output in the US, and I think that's true elsewhere, has been restored fully, and not just to serve our domestic markets, but also to serve our key important export markets. You know, we believe in the US in free, fair, and reciprocal trade. And that's not just words, that's demonstrated by our exports of roughly $140 billion and our imports of roughly $130+ billion. So we rely not just on exports, but also imports from our key trading partners of Canada and Mexico, other countries throughout the Western Hemisphere and the world, frankly. So supply chain is critical, critical opportunities. And I think post-COVID, we're going to go back and look and see how we can improve that. You know, I would expect maybe some automation where it doesn't exist to ensure if ever circumstances repeat themselves, we will be able to deal with them seamlessly. Third, I want to touch upon, and these are topics my colleagues have touched upon as well, is it also highlights policies of different governments that are protectionist or otherwise trade distorting, whether tariff or non-tariff trade barriers that aren't supported by sound science and data. The typical reaction is to constrain in the midst of a pandemic like COVID-19. There, we saw early on some measures by other countries that restricted exports, that tried to increase stockpiles of products, inventories. We've came out very early, very clearly that the U.S. was open for business. We're going to continue to serve not just U.S. domestic, but also export markets and our great partners throughout the world. And we've continued to do that. So it's imperative. It goes without saying that we need to continue individually and collectively addressing protectionism and trade distorting policies where we find them. I've got two more topics, and forgive me if I get a little passionate about these two, because I truly believe they're fundamental to future opportunities for food and agriculture. The first one, and it's one I love to talk about, and it's been happening for decades improperly, and that's communication. We need to communicate transparently and truthfully about production agriculture and about food safety. There has been so much misinformation and disinformation about technologies utilized by our farmers and our ranchers that have been discovered by big companies, medium-sized companies, small companies, that all are invaluable for meeting the needs of the growing world in terms of food production and for addressing the very issues that people hold near and dear, and so do we, and that's around sustainability. But really, we've got to look accurately at those three key pillars of sustainability and communicate truthfully with data about environmental impacts, economic impacts, and social impacts of the various agricultural and food policies enacted by various governments. Fifth, we need to promote, and it goes hand in hand with this communication, we need to promote innovation and the reasonable regulation of new technologies. At USDA, Secretary Perdue announced the Agricultural Innovation Agenda in February of 2020 at our Ag Outlook Forum. That was in conjunction with our friends from Canada, Mexico, and other leaders from Western Hemisphere countries. We have announced that by 2050, we aim to increase productivity by 40% of U.S. agriculture to meet the world's growing needs while reducing our environmental footprint in half. Our goals include water quality, carbon sequestration, renewable energy, and reduction of food loss and waste. And let me address one of the common misperceptions. One of the misperceptions are that innovation is purely about increasing production, about increasing the yield per acre or the percent of yield of beef or pork through the processing process. That's not accurate. Clearly, innovation can increase productivity, but it can also improve the quality of the food that is being produced. I've seen firsthand the power of these technologies that can increase protein content, increase healthy oils, reduce waste, and a multitude of other benefits that far too often aren't discussed when we're talking about the very technologies that are being discovered and implemented. The possibilities are endless. Now, innovation isn't just going to occur because the United States and USDA is promoting innovation. We are true believers that this requires an international effort, not just from the public sector, but from the public and private sectors working together. And this is where I'd circle back and say thank you again to IECA and other organizations we can work with to actually promote innovation and the reasonable regulation of that innovation based on science and data. Lastly, when it comes to innovation, let me contrast the U.S. agricultural innovation agenda with the European Union's misguided strategies, which it has labeled as farm to fork and biodiversity, that are underpinned by the precautionary principle and hazard-based risk assessments instead of proper risk assessments. While the Europeans express some admirable goals that we would agree 100% with them on as it relates to sustainability, some of the policies advocated as part of those strategies would result in limiting production, increasing subsidies, inhibiting trade, and stifling the very innovation that's needed to address the world's needs. So we look forward to dialogue with them bilaterally, but also multilaterally, together with our partners throughout the Western Hemisphere and within the context of international organizations as well. So thank you for the opportunity to talk about these topics and look forward to continuing our dialogue.
Thank you very much, Ken. Let me move on to the third and final question related with international cooperation, which is something crucial for historical mandate of ICA. And the question is how the Northern region could keep on supporting the development of agriculture in developing countries, especially in Central American and Caribbean countries. Under my administration, I emphasize that ICA has to build bridges between regions, and nothing better than the example of the Northern region building bridges with other regions, and especially, I once again emphasize, Central America and the Caribbean region. So, Ken, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Director General. And yeah, first and foremost, in terms of how to promote international cooperations to better develop ag systems throughout the Western Hemisphere, I think it starts again with communication and dialogue. The ability to address not just issues we're comfortable with, but as my colleague Miguel highlighted earlier, issues that may be uncomfortable to talk about. But that's where we have to rely on that strong relationship and alignment of mutual interests at a high level to help us make progress. Obviously, a key way to do that is through organizations like IECA, who can provide the forum for us to have those communications and engage in that dialogue. So first and foremost, I would ask everyone to commit to participating in IECA fully, the organization and the events that you host. And again, we need to focus on areas where we have common interests, like plant and animal pests and disease. They respect no borders. we need to work together as a Western Hemisphere to address those issues. And I think we do so fairly effectively. We also need to work on issues of trade to ensure we have open markets for trade where necessary, but also food aid. One of the pleasures that I have in my agency is to help administer certain food aid programs that the United States is engaged in. Nothing more discouraging to me when there are impediments, whether they're supply chain or import restrictions, to even food aid that are based on trade or import restrictions from countries not based on science and data. And last, and this was brought up as well, common issues we have on labor and the flow of immigration across the Western Hemisphere and how that can be stabilized working together. We need to use other international organizations effectively. We are strong supporters of CODEX, OIE, IPPC, and maintaining the mandates of those organizations to come out with model regulations based on science and data without the political overtones that countries would put into place. We need to support scientific exchanges. We have programs that are funded by our Congress under our Farm Bill that enable us to host scientific exchanges like Cochrane and Borlaug across many, many countries, particularly some countries that would be in that Central America, South America regions, where we can share best practices. We can share common understanding of the challenges we have, how those can be addressed, and build relationships, frankly, that help ensure that resiliency throughout time. And then we need to work together with the private sector. I think we've had the great privilege of working with Canada, Mexico, Brazil, Argentina as part of the Ag Five, and with AICA as part of the broader Western Hemisphere group, and many other countries. But the power we have in terms of influencing the world to adopt technologies that we hold near and dear is incredibly powerful. So we need to utilize that. We need to work together as countries, but also with our various private sector allies within our countries. So those are some of my ideas. There's a lot of opportunities, Director General, and I'm looking forward to what my colleagues have to say in this area as well.
Thank you very much, Ken. Miguel, your turn.
Thank you, Director General. Ken, thank you so much for this important insights on some of the things that we need to be doing. I think first of all, let me reiterate the Mexican commitment to support international organizations and AICA, particularly AICA, on all the efforts. We are facing two types of challenges, what to do, and the other is how to support and finance what we propose. I think the pandemic is the economic constraint that this disease is putting in all the countries is greatly going to affect what international organizations can do in terms of international cooperation. And that's a reality that we need to start facing. How do we continue to help international organizations to do their job under very dire economic conditions? And that's not an easy solution. Part of the solution, I think, will come into asking international organizations to refocus their work in areas of common interest for the regions and for the countries. I think that's a rather important transformation. And I can tell you that recently we have had an initiative led by ICA and FAO in Mexico, where we are asking them to help us to reshape some of our institutional arrangements and also to set goals for the development of critical food chains in the southeastern Mexico. And that probably is a way of working together. I think ICA is taking a big lead on this. Also, I had to recognize the role of FAO too. In terms of the northern region, and I know there's some criticism about the previous, some of the institutional mechanisms that ICA has created in the past, ProSinorte. I think ProSinorte continues to be an underutilized element in the cooperation from the northern region to the rest of the countries. And I think we need to work together to revitalize ProSinorte, whatever name we want to give it, whatever name we want to know it in the future. But that could be the place for some of the action that Ken is proposing. For example, communication, dialogue, scientific exchange, innovation. Those are areas that the Northern region can really provide with very low cost and high effective to other countries, particularly to the Caribbean countries. I think that's an area that provides an opportunity to rethink how do we reshape this institution. And also, I think for the Northern region, it's already been clear that there are three major issues that will be more interested in working. What are innovations, really? I think there is no progress without innovation. And that's true today, and it will be true in the future. And it has to do with quality of food, better integration, et cetera, et cetera. The other thing that we think is important has to do with health. Health issues, animal and plant health issues, and that's a critical role that we want to see always to be discussed by ICA. Pandemics such as the one we are having, that is in the human side, is an example of the need that we have to continue cooperation on animal and plant health issues. We have locust infestation coming throughout the continent, and it started in Africa. We have it now in the Americas. The swine fever. Recently, there was some communication that in Brazil there was some sort of new swine fever appearing. So I think the issue of health and animal and plant health is a priority that we all could benefit. And the issue of trade. Those are the three issues that I think are important for a region. There are some other ways in which our region can contribute. In the past, if you remember, Mexico offered scholarships for countries in the Caribbean, and that's something that we can probably discuss again to see if we can offer some sort of programs once this pandemic is over or in the new reality, or new normality, to short-term training, either by bringing the people into our research and educational institutions or by sending some of our people to train, short and long-term training in the Caribbean, region. One of the advantages that Mexico has, obviously, I probably won't offend anyone today, we have more tropical experience, probably, than the other two countries, and that's something that the Caribbean region would benefit greatly, is on the tropical agriculture. And probably those are the areas that I see. My major concern, honestly, is on the financial end for the future of this international cooperation. Hopefully, through the pandemic, we will continue to recognize the role of these international organizations. For me, maybe because I am part of those international organizations, I see greatly their value, their honest brokerage role that they have. But there are some people, especially in some ministries, that provide funding and budgetary and define the budget, that probably do not appreciate the role of this or international organization. So if we make the international organization more meaningful to our national purposes, if we focus on innovation, animal and plant health, and trade, and also if we design some sort of a technical, scientific, and educational exchange is important. And I will encourage, honestly, to review ProSinorte, whatever name we want to give it. I think we need to bring the research capacity of the United States, the research capacity of Mexico, the research capacity of Canada. And if we could put together the research capacity of Argentina, Brazil, and a few other countries, that will really help in some of the things that have to do with social, scientific advancements, innovations, communications, and new technologies. So I think those are areas that we would like to continue to work and to support. And support, and also I just want to finish by reiterating the commitment by our secretary to ICA. He is more than convinced that ICA has a very important and potential role to play and transform the agricultural sector in the region. Thank you.
Miguel, Frederick, your remarks, please.
Yes, thank you very much, Director General. And I think that there's sometimes advantages to link back to what Ken was saying at the beginning. Sometimes there's advantages of going last. It's that I think it shows on this topic that there's a lot of complementarity of the points. So I think I will not overlap too much. But I think that the current situation has shown that the importance of regional and international organization is primary. I praise again AICA as well as the FAO, G20, APEC, the WTO. All the organizations have been quick to try to adjust, to organize countries to have the necessary policy discussions that we need to have, and how we deal with the, we avoid policies that exacerbate the negative impact of the that we're facing right now. I think we can learn lessons from the 2008 food crisis in that regard. I think that the response of AICA to COVID-19 has been important for the region, and it's a great example of coordination, how we can help manage things. You convene ministers. We are fostering information and sharing, and I agree with Ken that communication, facts, if there's issues that of concern among ourselves, the best way is to talk frankly. And AICA provides that kind of safe space to have these discussions. So fostering information sharing, providing technical advice through the Food Security Monitor, the Advisory Council for Food Security in the Americas, that has been invaluable. I see in my... in Canada, there's things that we had to deal with over the past 5 months that were quite unexpected. I can only imagine that if a country like Canada, and I'm sure Ken and Miguel would agree, like we have a fairly long tradition of government oversight, and we were taken by surprise on many things. I can only imagine for smaller economies in the hemisphere how it is. So the work through AICA, under the auspices of AICA, can really help to try to address a number of these issues. So like Ken was saying, for the United States, Canada will continue to strongly support the work of AICA in that area and to be as active as possible in using those forests to advocate policies that support the recovery as well as a robust and a sustainable agriculture systems in the Americas. Of course, I mentioned earlier our commitment to multilateralism. It's part of the equation, of course. So we are active also at the FAO. And Ken noted your point, your concerns that we fully share about what how some jurisdiction cast the farm to fork initiative. We're concerned what under novel auspices and principles, what is behind that, and we are concerned about the impact it could have, first and foremost, on the most vulnerable economies. So we will continue to work closely with friends at the FAO in those regards. So in addition to the multilateralism, Canada, like the United States and Mexico, we have an active program of international development assistance. And agriculture and the food systems is a big element of that. In that context, one thing I would like to mention is Canada's Feminist International Assistance Program. This is something that is very important, and our minister being a former Minister of International Development and a former worker in the field, in development in West Africa, she's very committed to that that agenda. I think as recognized by AK through your project, Warriors, and which I think in Spanish you call Luchadoras. I think that's like, this is a good reminder how crucial, how central role women are playing in the development of agricultural economies throughout the hemisphere. So that's why it's a big element. Our Feminist International Assistance Program has a big focus, a big connection with agriculture. So we are trying to find gender transformative approaches in agriculture that can address the underlying causes of gender inequality, which we think is really undermining the in many economies the economic development. So we have examples of work that we do in this area, promoting women's leadership and decision making in governance of agriculture, increasing access to technological innovations, practices that increase productivity, improve resilience of stocks, reduce the labor burden for women, all these kinds of elements. So it's a team that is quite dominant in our approach. We also support integrating climate action as a central element of the sustainable food system transition in developing countries. And we think, Director General, we know, and we are supportive of the emphasis that you have put since you assume your role, of especially dealing with the challenges of the island, small economies, the Caribbean. So the climate, the link with the climate action, we think is especially relevant in that regard. The last thing I would say is that we think that we have bilateral programs of development that we're looking through a lens of Caribbean, small economies, and agriculture. So our bilateral programs that we have through our Global Affairs Canada is, I think, can be put to good contribution. The last thing I would say is, in response to Miguel, Proce Norte is something that is an initiative that has delivered a lot of goods over the years. It is probably a need to take it to be looked and reviewed to make it as efficient, but we this is a great vehicle to collaborate. There's a lot of diversity across just our three economies in the north region, and I think it can really connect well with the efforts of other groups that are science oriented throughout the hemisphere. So very positive in terms of continuing the dialogue on Proce Norte with Mexico and the U.S. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much once again, Miguel, Ken, and Frederick, for your contributions. I have to confess you that I enjoyed and learned a lot about agriculture in the northern region. And before passing the mic to Loy for some final remarks, Let me share with you that I am convinced that this continent represents the future for the humankind, for ensuring food and nutrition security. No question about it. We are, in fact, the most important exporting region all over the world. Having said that, we have a problem. And it's the fact that the Latin American and Caribbean region, for us, intra-regional trade is something not very common. Just 14.4% of us practice intra-regional trade. So you are the example to be followed. The northern region represents the example to be followed in the other part of the continent. So probably in the future, I personally would like to be discussing how to promote more intra-regional trade in the rest of the other Latin American countries. Having said that, Lloyd, the floor is yours for some final remarks, please.
Well, thank you, Director General, and thank you, Miguel, Ken, and Frederic. That was a very rich discussion. I think it could be a trade 101 or agricultural relations 101 class for students throughout the world. You touched on a number of very important issues, and a lot of it, you know, made me think about what's going on now with COVID, and also taking me back 20 years to when I worked with the USDA and all of your countries in order to promote science-based trade that helps our country, our constituents receive safe, healthy, quality, and affordable food that you all mentioned. I think one of the silver linings of this crisis that we're living through is it's brought us all together a lot more via these technologies. And in that, the intra-regional trade that the Director General just discussed has become more important, with ministers discussing on a frequent basis with the Director General, be it in the central region, the Caribbean region, the Andean region, or the Mercosur, how to eliminate barriers to the flow of goods. One of the things that I think we all should be proud about is that agriculture has become an essential element of business in all of our countries, and protection of the workers and protection of the food supply to get to consumers by maintaining trade and maintaining the flow and the safety of trade has been critically important. You all touch upon a number of issues, and I don't think I can touch on all of them in a summation. So I'd just like to thank you. I'd like to thank you for your contribution to this dialogue. I'd like to thank you for your support of EECA. I'd like to pledge for you that EECA will continue to work with you to build those bridges that the Director General talked about, of bringing all the wealth and the example and the knowledge of the North in agriculture to the rest of the hemisphere, and through that, improving this hemisphere's agriculture to share with the rest of the world. So thank you very much for being a part of this ongoing high-level series of dialogues by EECA, and we wish you all a very good afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Take care, Frederick. Take care, Miguel.
Take care, Ken and Miguel.
See you.
Thank you, Director General and Lloyd.
Bye.
Bye.